made you some content. Daddy made you your favorite open wide. Here comes the content. It's a beautiful day to stay inside.
Greetings, mood killers. It's Eddie here with Marconi as always. I was talking about this recently, maybe a couple of weeks ago, how I'm very annoyed lately that I open and hold the door open for somebody behind me as I'm exiting or entering.
You had me at very annoyed, by the way.
Yeah, no, I hold the door open for, I was saying, you know, for people going in and out of facilities.
Why?
Various facilities, grocery stores, you name it, doctor's offices, and they never say thank you. They never, ever say thank you to me.
I thought you were going to stop.
I've had it. I've got, well, I can't stop. I feel like there's something wrong with me because it's something that I said on the show that I was going to stop doing.
Yeah.
But I can't help myself.
You lied to the show.
So
you lied to our audience.
I'm here to apologize to the audience, A. And B, somebody thanked me today.
What?
Or yesterday, whatever the hell it was. Just, yeah, the other day, somebody actually said thank you. And my response to this person after this rant that I had on mood killers was, I said thank you back.
Oh, you
so
did.
Imagine this. Somebody says thank you for holding the door, yeah. And I say thank you.
Because I always hold
because
the door.
Because I was saying thank you to them saying thank you.
I say
kind
thank
of a weird
you.
Response.
Like when a woman is getting on the elevator or anybody's getting on the elevator, I always let them in. And unless I've got like a big package or some like, you know, something I'm pulling or something that's, then I get in first and then I hold the door for them. And I always, you always ask like, what floor are you on? That kind of stuff. But what I don't like is why is it like you have to ride this awkward elevator with people, and then when they get off, you have to tell them, have a nice day. I don't care how your day goes, you know? Like, what do I give a rat's ass about your day? I just want to get, I didn't even want to get on this elevator with the person. So, but you're opening
right.
doors for people and thanking them. And like,
yeah.
Is it just a natural reaction because you've been doing it for years and now you don't know how to stop?
No. Well, I mean, you'd think that'd be, they thank me and then I thank them for thanking me now. That's the thing. So they say thank you, then I say thank you for thanking me.
And your
me.
Dog Hugo has to be there for all this. He sees you doing it. That's why he's
that's
barking.
Right.
He hears you talking about it. He's like, no, he does it every time. It's really annoying.
Right.
And so
yeah.
are you trying to be better? Are you trying to help yourself not do it? Like, are you trying to hold back? Can you do it?
No, now I thank people for thanking me. That's
well,
what I do. That's my move from now on.
You're a polite
on.
Guy,
and
so what's wrong with that? I mean, I know what you're saying. It's annoying.
Because
but
it throws people off. It throws people off when I thank them after they thank me. Because shouldn't
no.
it be, you know,
oh,
you know
do,
what
but
I'm
you,
saying
do it,
here?
Do it jovially, like, no, thank you. Or do you just go, no, thanks. Oh, thanks. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. And then
it's
you go about
it's usually
your day.
Sarcastically, you know, like, thanks.
Oh. So that's why they look at you weird. Thanks. That's all I get? They should be tipping me
yeah.
a dollar. You should have a tip jar.
Yeah, that's it.
If people
yeah,
at places,
should.
If people can get tipped for just turning around with it and poking an iPad at you and turning around and grabbing something out of a refrigerator and handing it to you, then you can get tipped for opening a door. I think it's time.
Yeah.
Why not?
I know.
Well, you can hold that, and I want Eddie to. I'll send you a tip jar. Maybe that's what you need.
I'm gonna make one of those biker jackets, but it's gonna have a giant QR code on the back.
That's my tip. Yeah, finally, yes. Ladies and gentlemen,
celebrities. Yes.
Yes.
Well, I don't have celebrity news for you, but I do have celebrity connections. I thought this is kind of interesting, but I don't know. Maybe it's not. So,
okay.
For example, did you know that Elton John is Eminem's AA sponsor? Did you know that?
I didn't even know Eminem was in AA.
I didn't either. I learned a lot. Elton John is his sponsor because Elton John had problems at one point too, right? And then he got clean.
Yeah. I guess that's right.
Or here's another one. Keanu Reeves met Dolly Parton when he was a kid because his mom made costumes for her.
What?
Kind of interesting.
That's cool.
Yeah, because
I saw something. And that Keanu Reeves, was it Keanu Reeves and Winona Ryder were married on a show, but it was like by an actual minister. So it was like
they were actually married.
I don't know. I saw something. You know what? You see something and I'm like, oh, I should talk about this. And I forget to, tag it or bookmark it so I can look it back up. And I swear I saw that though. But
right.
I'm probably wrong.
Cameron Diaz went to high school with Snoop Dogg.
Okay. Are they the same age?
And she bought weed from him, I guess. I think so. Yeah,
that's weird.
Snoop Dogg is, I think he just turned 50 or something. That's about
right. Snoop Dogg, I mean, it's weird because he looks, good for his age, but also his age. And Cameron, you said Cameron Diaz. You didn't say Cameron, who did I think you were talking about?
I don't know.
Candace Cameron. I was thinking Candace Cameron. No. Candace I was like, she doesn't look like, she's not 50, is she? Like, what?
Yeah. And she doesn't buy weed.
No, but Cameron Diaz, I could see. Right, yeah. No.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Kevin James and WWE star Mick Foley went to high school together and
that tracks.
They were on the same wrestling team.
That tracks.
That tracks.
Kevin James. I don't know what it is with Kevin James, but you and I have noticed this. There's something about him that makes you think a-hole. Like I don't have any evidence of it. There's no, report. Like, the people that worked with him that didn't like him or anything. But I just get that vibe of, he probably wouldn't be a nice guy on set to a new actor for some reason.
Right.
I don't know.
Ed Sheeran and Jamie Foxx. Ed Sheeran, Jamie Foxx. They were born as conjoined twins.
No, they were not.
Okay, no, that's not what it says here. It says Ed Sheeran slept on Jamie Foxx's couch for 6 weeks.
Oh, yeah.
When he moved to L.A. for the first time.
Yeah, I've heard that story. I think Jamie Foxx used to do that for people that he thought had some talent and wanted to give them a chance. I think that's great because you're investing in someone who's going to make the world a better place. And I think Ed Sheeran has definitely done that. If you've ever been to one of his shows, he's spectacular.
Here's a fun hypothetical question. Say you lend me, Marconi, $10. And I go out and I buy a Powerball ticket. All right. And it wins the jackpot. Do you think that I then morally owe you a portion or even half of that Powerball jackpot?
No, but I don't think you would. You're the kind of guy. Now, maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. But you've helped me in a lot of different ways people don't know about, with my grandma when she was dying.
Right.
And you gave us, your life saving. No, nothing like that.
That pimple on your back.
Yeah. But you just seem like that kind of guy that would help somebody out. And you're really good about money. So I think you might have a consideration because you and I are technically business partners and mood killers. And I don't know. You might make it so I don't have to work is all I'm saying. You might be that kind of, 'cause I would do that for you.
Yeah. I mean, I would do it for you too. I think if you lent me $10 and especially if I made the intention known that I was going to go buy a lottery ticket.
Right.
I think I would say, okay, cool. Thank you for the $10. If I win, you get half. I think that would just come out of my mouth instinctively.
Oh, really?
And I would mean it, too. I would mean it. Because it's like, if I really need to buy a Powerball ticket that bad and somebody's going to give me the money, I think you're obligated to split that jackpot 50-50, I feel.
Obligated, I don't know. But I feel like you're of the mind.
Well, you should. It's the right thing to do.
$10, though. Just give the $10 back. Here's a crisp.
That's what a lot of people say is this is, a controversial thing people are talking about on the internet.
It depends on the person, honestly, though. Because, if it was you, definitely. I would be happy to split it with you. I probably would do it anyway. If I had success, knowing all the stuff you and I have gone through, you're a friend that if you won, the $1 billion jackpot or whatever, I'm not going to, What am I going to do with all that money? I could make your life really comfortable. I wouldn't
Sure, yeah.
I wouldn't be mad to do that.
I'd give you a whole bunch of money for sure. And, you know, do whatever you want with it. Go have fun.
Yeah, but I think the thing is that like, we'll just buy our own radio stations with all that money, and then we won't have to ask gatekeepers to be our affiliates for radio, you know? We'll just buy them.
All the stations you want to be on.
You don't want us on your station? How about if we just buy it and still make you run it with us on it?
Yeah.
And then now we're your boss. You like that?
Right.
So, no, I like that idea, though. Are you playing the Powerball, by the way? I mean, I don't know.
No.
I don't ever.
I mean, when they say it's one of those record-breaking jackpots, I might buy one ticket, and I don't know why I do it. I fall for it every time. I'll pay $2 or whatever. But it's not something I do regularly. I think it's a waste of money. You're never going to win. And no, I just feel bad gambling in general. So I don't.
And it's always somebody, you see the person that wins, and I would hate that, first of all. If you're going to win something, I want to do it in complete silence. Like some guy won, we don't know who, it's an anonymous winner. That's it.
Yeah.
And then you would probably still see me doing all the things. I would just maybe own my building where I live.
Sure.
And I just convert. I would you know, still make money off of the apartments maybe, but I would have like the top two floors would just be me. You know,
I think what I would do, the first thing I would do is buy Facebook and then rename it to Y.com.
Why? What do you mean?
Because X, after X. You know,
Twitter's now X. you might want to hire a couple of consultants. I'm just saying.
Yeah. No. Okay.
Eddie, it's time for you to learn a few things. Eddie, did you know the fountains at the Mall of America in Minneapolis collect about $25,000 in coins every year? Still, I don't understand that. Like, people say the Mall of America, you got to go to the Mall of America. From what I see, it's just a mall. And you got to be around.
It's just a massive, it sounds like an anxiety attack is what it sounds like.
Yeah.
It sounds like you go in there. This happened to me in Las Vegas because they have that Miracle Mile, which is basically a giant, you know, shopping center. That's a mile. And you walk in that thing and there's only one entrance and one exit. And I didn't realize that the first time I walked in there. And I was tired. It was the end of a night. And, you know, I had just been out at some event. And I just wanted to get home. And I walk into this thing thinking it was a shortcut back to my hotel. And about halfway through that thing, I was sweating. I was getting a panic attack because there was no way out of this damn thing.
Even that greasy cake vending machine couldn't save you. You know, they have that cake.
No.
They have that cake vending machine. It looks so good. They fill that cake with like canola oil. It's like so filled like, that it preserves it. So it lasts for days and weeks. And it looks good in the case. Like you're walking, you're sweating, and you're like, I could have a beverage and some cake, and then it tastes like foot rot. I don't know. It's disgusting.
Mm-hmm.
But so don't.
Yeah,
you know,
but that's
don't
how the Mall of America is. It's the same thing. It's that times 20. Like, why would you want to do that? And how many? I wonder how many Cinnabon they have though. Do you think they have more than one? They've got to.
Cinnabon would be good. Yeah, it might be worth it for the Cinnabon.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Right.
Here's another one, Eddie. Did you know the first thing someone invented that could break the sound barrier was a whip? I guess that makes sense. So I was thinking about Indiana Jones. You were talking about them doing another Indiana Jones with Harrison Ford.
Right.
That's right. Now, this one, I don't know if people remember who Johnny Carson is, but he was the Tonight Show host for a lot of years in the 90s. I think he went back to the 60s. Through the 90s, like 30 years something before, who was the guy after? Oh, Jay Leno and then Conan and then now Jimmy Fallon. But this is a guy way back in the day, Johnny Carson. He liked being alone so much that his $81 million home in Malibu, California, only had one bedroom, which meant he never had to host any guests. And I'm like, well, I'm no Johnny Carson, but I have a one bedroom and I don't have to host any guests. I do have a really comfortable couch. Like if somebody's, you know, Like if you said, hey, I don't have any place to stay, could I sleep on your couch? Of course I'm going to say yes. But there's not a lot of people like that, that I would be like, yes, please stay over. I'm not excited about it. I would have to have a much bigger house to be comfortable with that. And people to take care of you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there's a few. Did you know? Did you know? Eddie, did you know when you're on a plane, you're under the laws of the country where the plane is registered, not where they take off from? So if you punch somebody on Air Canada, you'll face charges in Canada. It's crazy.
Interesting. I have wondered about that. Okay. That's good to know.
So can you not fly? You have to have your passport and everything too? Because if that's the case, then wouldn't you have to have all your papers in order? All that kind of stuff?
I don't know.
That's weird.
I just wonder, what country is it not a crime for me to commandeer the plane and just go for a little joyride?
I think every country. Don't try it. Don't be doing it.
Don't try
it. Here's another one. And of course, I think you probably knew this. Did you know the Hollywood sign was originally created by an advertising agency in the 20s to promote a new real estate development? Hollywood.
Okay.
That sign, I mean, I know it's iconic, but it kind of is a bunch of garbage, isn't it? It's just a metal thing that sits up there. Another thing, you know, like, why? It's like the Mall of America. You go, okay, so you hike your ass. You have to go all the way up to this thing, and it's like a cutoff road. You can't drive it or anything. And then, you're up against the sign. You can't see it because you're up against this giant letters. And what are you going to do?
Yeah, it's dumb. I mean, you can see the Hollywood sign from certain parts of the city, but those are areas that you don't really want to be in very long. It's, you know, terrible areas.
Right. I mean, it's interesting at best, and it's famous. You know, you see it in a lot of movies, all that stuff. I mean, when I see it, it reminds me of Hollywood Video. Remember Blockbuster's biggest competitor, Hollywood Video?
Yeah.
They had a sign on their thing that had that logo. Okay, here's another one. Now, if you remember the show Family Matters, Jaleel White, a.k.a. Steve Urkel.
Yeah.
Was also the voice of Sonic the Hedgehog in several Sonic cartoons in the 1990s.
For some reason, I did know that, but I forgot it. That's interesting, yeah.
I mean, I'm guessing that's where he got his mansion from. Maybe not from Urkel. I don't know.
Could be.
I'm always baffled, you know, when people say, whatever happened to that person? Like, there's no guarantee that you're going to ever have another show ever again. You know, you might get one shot. It happens in a lot of places. You think, this is going to last forever, and then it just doesn't. So what? It's okay. But what people don't understand is, like, mostly people, they make exuberant salaries on some of these shows, and then maybe they don't have to work for, like, 15 years.
Well, and that's the point is, like, I think they make these giant salaries because it's so fickle. So it could be the last gig you ever have. So you have to look at it that way, too.
Yeah, and a lot of people,
they get they're overpaid, but, you know.
Well, they live on it. Like, some people know that, and they go, I'm going to sock all this away that I can and just live on whatever I can get away with and live comfortably, but live on the minimum amount, like below my means.
Yeah.
And then some people do, like, you know, like they're living on the edge. They'll spend all of it. They got to have a car. They've got to have a mansion. They've got to have, you know, all this stuff. And the taxes are insane, and they just go nuts, and they blow that whole wad, and then they don't get another job. And so but I think Jaleel White may have figured it out. Do some voiceover. That's what a lot of people are doing now. Voiceover work. Cause they can do that from home.
Yeah. My inspiration in life, Jaleel White. I follow anything.
Me too. Same.
I love the movie theater chains where they serve you food and beverages.
Yes.
It's great to sit down and there's a little menu there. There's a guy with a flashlight. He'll come up. He'll like kind of crawl. He'll army crawl and then give you a ham sandwich.
I've never seen that. Is that maybe that's extra. Here's what I think. Because they have like a turkey wrap at some of these, and they have like fries, right? Those are easy finger foods to do. But I don't want like full bone-in wings. That's a messy job to try to do.
Oh, no, and it's dark in there. Some things should not be served in a movie theater with these restaurants or these.
You got to have a boneless
because you can't see
wing,
anything.
Chicken nugget, whatever it is. That's fine.
Yeah.
But, yeah, anything that you... Like, I don't want a big slice of pizza. That's too much. You know, just finger food type stuff. And, like, a wrap is okay. But
well,
like,
you know, there's one person that hates all of this that we're talking about. You and I are fans. And, I'm actually a fan of the person
that said this. Yeah.
In GQ. Yeah, a famous comedian and actor. He came out and said that he hates it when movie theaters serve dinner and drinks. I'll tell you who this actor is in a second, but first here's the quote.
Yeah.
He says, "I hate it. I can't stand it. It makes no sense to combine booze with movies.
Oh.
You're going to have to pee. Alcohol does not make you want to get up and lose it." I think it's saying, makes you want to get up and pee. "You don't want to sit there, drink beer, and be quiet. You want to, talk when you're pounding IPAs."
I see.
Is what he's saying, essentially.
Right.
So, the actor that is against movie theaters serving dinner and drinks, Danny McBride. And I love Danny McBride.
Danny McBride. Oh, he's the guy, Eastbound and Down?
Eastbound and Down. Eastbound and Down. And
I wish I could hear his voice
that
doing
new one,
it.
The religious one right now that he does, the Righteous Gemstones.
Oh, yeah,
Gemstones.
Righteous Gemstones. I love that. Yeah, we have clips on that show. Like, we have,
don't think I won't bend you over my knee and turn that fat ass red now.
Yeah,
that's not him.
You know, if I were to hear him railing against these movie theater chains,
what are you being a negative ninny for?
There he is. Negative.
What are you being a negative ninny for?
Anything he does in that voice, you have to laugh at. But I wonder if he really feels this way, or if he's just trying to be funny. Because I love these movie theaters. I love them.
Maybe he's like thinking of the fact that like he's put a lot of work in, and people are going to drink, and then have to use the restroom and miss a bunch of the stuff that he'd put together. So
what does he
care?
They already bought the ticket, you know?
He wants them to see his
That's what he's there for, is to sell the ticket. Look, he got in the door.
Movie theaters are just trying to do anything to get people
to stay afloat.
Keep going, and stay afloat. Because even the ones where they're like, "Oh, yeah, we had a record-breaking weekend. Thanks a lot, Tom Cruise," or whoever the hell. It's few and far between of people going to movies like Barbie and Oppenheimer. And what else?
Yeah.
I don't know any other movies that I would leave the house to go see now. Like, there's not a lot. So, and they're usually...
Deuce like, Bigelow 3 might get me off my couch.
Finally, yes. Wow, yeah. Now you're talking.
Well, Marconi, I kind of like this, but it will make some people angry. And it's a law that some California lawmakers are considering. And if it passes
Did you say
California,
law? You know how much I hate laws.
That's right. If it passes in California, you know, other states are going to adopt this. It's a law that will make it illegal, a crime for your boss to regularly contact you after business hours.
Oh, I like that. No, I do. Here's why. Because a lot of bosses don't understand that the separation between church and state. They don't get it.
No,
they don't
right.
respect it. And... they'll often the toxic work environments will have people like, "Well, you don't really, you're not a team player because you won't stay after." Now, what about if I am just really efficient with my job and I don't need to work 17 hours a day? I can get it done within the time I'm at work, usually a lot less.
Right.
And maybe I should teach you how to do it, boss. You can't get it. You're the boss and you can't get it done within the hours of work and let it go?
Well, they're calling this the legal right to disconnect. And if any employer violates it, they could face a fine of at least $100 per offense.
Yeah.
That's
hard part
money.
About it is I don't know that there needs to be, maybe there doesn't need to be a law, but you know, like, cause here's what happens. Like, okay, so where do you go? You call the cops? Like, what do? You don't tell HR because HR is for the company. So you tell HR you've created a problem, and then suddenly you're the problem. They find a way to get rid of you. So everyone's going to be scared to, like, report. Like, who are you going to report it to? Like, his boss? Like, I don't think you're, I don't think it's going to go well. Like, unless there's like an office that you report to and they have to adhere to those rules. There's no, I don't see anybody really, you know, like,
yeah, it's a law that I think,
wasn't really thought through.
I think that it's important for people to what I'd rather have people be fighting for first, though, is a 4-day work week before they start in on this. Cause this is a little, maybe this is the second step to me. It's a little premature. I get it.
Livable
though.
Wages, you know, should be up there too. Like, I think there's got to come a time when these companies obviously aren't getting the hint that, like, people are, you know, not making it very well and having to have all these side jobs just to get by. It's enough with that. Like, because everybody's getting by now with, you know what we're going to do? You want to do a side hustles. We'll just make every job a side hustle and we'll never have to pay healthcare again. So, okay. Yeah. Then what's going to happen? I feel like they don't understand, like, they're not investing in people. So suddenly when the economy starts crumbling, then what happens then? Because nobody can buy anything. They can't afford food. Right. We just die. Is that the idea? You want people to not have a choice. You want to ban abortion, but then, you know, you want people to just die on the vine because they can't afford to live. So what is it? Make a decision. You want people to live or do you want them to die? You can't have it both ways. You think you can, but you can't.
Especially, do not text me during Wheel.
Wheel of Fortune. Yeah, that's off limits. I know that. Wheel. Everyone should know that.
Another great day together here, Marconi, on the radio. We had a lot of fun, as always.
Well, if you say so, it's got to be true.
Yeah. Yeah, we talked about a lot of things. We talked about Danny McBride saying that he doesn't like movie theaters that serve dinner and drinks.
What is wrong with that guy? I mean,
I love the guy. I don't know. I hate to disagree with him because I do love him. He's a hilarious, talented actor and comedian.
He essentially does the same character in every show, though, right? Like, I've never seen him play a different character.
He does, but I'm okay with it. I'm totally okay with it because nobody else does that character.
Right. Yeah.
So, you know, then he comes out and says, oh, I don't want people to enjoy themselves with libations and sliders
you're talking about these theaters that, you know, they charge a little bit extra, and usually it detracts from parents dropping their kid off at the theater, and there aren't a bunch of kids running around, so it's kind of good in that regard.
Yeah, they're like adult theaters in a way, because, you know, they you sit down and they have a menu, then people will army crawl to your seat with a daiquiri.
Don't you think? The only thing I think about it is I like the chairs and I like the arm crawling with the daiquiri and a sandwich. But the chairs are almost too comfortable. It's like you're laying down.
Well, that
down.
Was part of his thing, too. We didn't get to that earlier, but that's what Danny McBride was saying. He's saying that you have a couple of
highballs
and you're sitting in these comfy chairs. You're sleeping through Killers of the Flower Moon, which is riveting for 5.5 hours.
I don't like to be that vulnerable to complete strangers in the dark room where I'm just sitting there. You're like, you know, probably man spreading because you got that space. It's a huge chair. It's like a giant lazy boy, basically. And you're sitting there, you know, maybe with some friends, but then, you have a, because those, the beer they serve like, it's almost like a baseball bat of beer. You can sit on the
floor.
And
it's 8.5 and higher. That's part of the law there.
Yeah, so I don't know. I see his point, but I really do like those theaters. And I do like getting, like, finger foods and, like, maybe a wrap or something. But I also, I don't really need to eat at the theater. I can eat before or after. That's fine, too.
What I like about it is it combines dinner and a movie into one, which is a great idea. I always thought, because you don't have a lot of time. Sometimes it's stressful to try to go to the Sizzler and then rush across the street to the Cineplex.
The Sizzler. Yeah, no, I agree. Yeah. I mean, take that cheesecake to go from the Sizzler. Can we take our cheesecake?
People are They smuggle movie or they smuggle food into candy. The theater anyways.
Yeah.
So I was at a theater once and some guy, he had the guts to have a full pizza delivered to his seat. I thought that was a bold move.
Yeah.
So these theaters have wisened up and they're saying, yeah, we'll serve wine. We'll give you food. Just stay right here. Everything's okay if you order from us. I don't know. I like it. Anyway, sorry, Danny McBride.
You don't have to apologize. It's just his opinion. It's not like you're hurting his feelings. You know?
He's upset that I don't agree.
That's probably true. He's like waiting. Like, as long as Eddie agrees with me, I'll be fine. I don't care if anybody else, the hate, if I get hate letters or DMs on my whatever social media, I don't care. But if Eddie likes it, then I'm good. But you don't. Right, you don't agree with him. So he's going to be very upset. You've screwed us. We'll never have Danny McBride on this show. You know what I mean?
What have you been a negative ninny for?
I can't help
it. Sorry, Dan.
Yeah.
D-Man. Sorry. But yeah, we talked about that a lot more. Also, Marconi brought in some did you know tidbits. We love those.
Oh, man. Here's
I'm
one.
Sure you have one that you want to close us out with. Yeah.
Let's see which one would be good for to say goodbye.
Yeah. Let's say goodbye with a did you know.
Here you go.
Leave people with a little bit of knowledge. Yeah.
Matthew McConaughey is terrified of revolving doors. Tyra Banks is terrified of dolphins. Johnny Depp is terrified of clowns. I think everyone's terrified of clowns, so it's not special. But revolving
and
doors?
Everyone's terrified of Johnny Depp.
That's right.
Do not text me during wheel.